First question, well, I'll read a few of them because they're all together here. Are we supposed to just go on with the church and ignore the politics, or do we confront the state, and if we are met with physical opposition, what then? From three of us, where do we go from here? What do we do now? My question is about how we fight to preserve our right to educate our children. This is Obamacare attacks Catholic institutions. Catholic education is also threatened. Since it's all over, should we stop fighting against Obama and the group and just prepare for jail and execution? Yeah. First of all, on the, I saved the jail and execution question just for the end, because I'd like to answer the questions in reverse or address them in reverse. When we were in Romania, we were there to speak, as I told you at the beginning, as a conference for young people, but that conference happened in Iași. We were in Bucharest for 3 days, and while we were there, I'd done a lot of research going into Romania and going up to the trip, and I had no idea until I really started heavily researching it, the amount, the intensity of the persecution that the church went through in Romania under the communists. It is absolutely mind-boggling. And our host, I was interviewed on a Romanian national television, and while we were there in preparation for it, and the host of the show, a young fellow probably about 27, 28, named Stefan, said afterwards, he said, oh, you seem like you'd be very interested. You seem to know a lot about Romanian history. Do you know that, as I referenced in the interview, I referenced the persecution of the church. He said, you know, one of the major prisons is just 30 minutes south of here. I said, oh, really? He said, yes. Yeah. So he made arrangements and everything. We got to go in. The prison, the prison has two parts to it. One part is still an active prison, and they've updated it and everything. And the other one, the other half of the place, is a gulag, and it really is one of the Russian gulags. And we went in there. They gave us permission to go in there with our cameras. And next week, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, for those of you who follow us at Church Militant TV or the old RealCatholicTV.com, the Vortex, next Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. We go into the prison with our cameras and show you the actual physical place. I have to tell you, this is horrifying. It's absolutely horrifying. And when I got in there, I was saying Hail Marys and saying, thank you, Blessed Mother, for the grace to be able to come and tell the story of these brave men. There were women in another part of the prison, but where we were was the men. These brave people, they suffered humiliations like you could not imagine in your wildest dreams. And particularly, there was an area, because it's diabolical, there was an area of that prison reserved for Catholic priests and bishops. And the tortures they went through, there was a program, a re-indoctrination, a re-education program specifically for Catholic priests, and it was called the Pateshki experiment. And it went on for about 3.5 years, and it was named after the town another prison was in, but once it was developed there, it was exported to a couple of other prisons, including the one we were in, which was called Jilapa. And just to give you a sample of what happened, they would bring priests in and put them in a room called the Black Cell, because it was absolutely pitch black, 2 stories underground, damp, dank, stinky, rats, everything. And they would sleep. And what they didn't know initially is inside that room, it was pitch black, when they were asleep, when they finally were able to fall asleep, there was somebody in there with a light who would turn the light on and take a rubber hose, a trench, and just beat the living daylights out of the soles of their feet. And they did this every time they fell asleep for days on end until they became sort of, the priest prisoner became sort of conditioned like one of Pavlov's dogs, that to fall asleep would bring pain, so they wouldn't fall asleep. Their bodies just responded and wouldn't let them fall asleep, and they became sort of like zombies. And that period was called, that phase of the torture was called unmasking. And once they had unmasked them, as if that wasn't enough, then they moved to phase two, which was called masking. And I don't know exactly what those things are in reference to, but and what they did is they trained them in their zombie-like state to now become the persecutors of the next group of priests brought in. And the guards used to delight themselves doing every humiliation they could with these guys, so while they were in their zombie-like state, particularly on Christmas and Good Friday, they would take the priests into the black room, the black cell, and they'd give them a cup chalice that they'd confiscated from one of the churches, and they would smear the inside of it with human feces, pour a little bit of wine in it, and say, okay, here, Father, offer mass to all your other priests, and you have to drink from it. So, the stuff that happened in there was horrible. And I think to myself, we're always kind of joking in the studio, all of us saying, we don't mind dying for the faith or being tortured for the faith. Oh, that's a different... but so I just made that reference at the end there. You know, whatever it takes, many, many saints ascended to heaven directly from those prison cells. And torture chambers, let's be real, and torture chambers, they weren't just prison cells. Father John Harden, many of you are probably aware of Father John Harden, the exquisite Jesuit, said that American, he was a very loyal American, loved the country, etc. Catholics, American Catholics that do not start living their faith with the zeal of the first century Catholics will lose their faith. And it really, really, it really takes, all of these martyrs became martyrs because they lived in the grace of martyrdom and they simply crowned their lives with martyrdom. They're already living as martyrs, and that's the point. We must become holy. We must become holy. In reference to what do we do, sometimes detect a note of discouragement or something, I like to sort of liken this to the Martha Mary example. Prayer and action, both. But first, prayer and personal sanctification. That's what the sacraments are for. That's why God has given us the grace of the Holy Spirit through the sacraments to remain personally holy. After that, action. Even if all of our efforts fail politically, culturally, civilly, whatever, the truth is worth defending. Remember that in the, you know, what we are defending ultimately is Christ, is our blessed Lord. That's who we're defending. It's not a concept. It's expressed in conceptual terms, but it's more than a concept. And we really need to think in terms like that. You know, so many of us, guilty as charged, so many of us can so easily get wrapped up in the comfort of the American materialist, Charlie and I did all over Europe was complain that they don't have ice in this continent. Every time you ask for a drink, they give you something warm. Like, why don't you have ice here? And then you walk into Jalapa and you start to hear these, and you're like, oh, I feel like a jerk. We really, really, it is the work of the Holy Spirit to sanctify us, and we have to be open to that. And I don't mean just open, saying the rosary, going to mass, yes, all those things. But we have to make determined, concerted efforts in our lives to learn the faith. And I don't mean just learn, third grade, fourth grade thing. You need to stop doing what you're doing with your free time now and pour it into learning the truth of the faith. Somehow figure out, I can't speak to any of your circumstances because they're not my circumstances. But whatever you're doing, get on the internet, go to bookstores, get DVDs, listen to audios, go to conferences. Learn the faith. Learn the faith. If you don't learn the faith, if you don't know the faith, how can you say you love it? And we get into heaven on love. In the end, three things abide: faith, hope, and love, charity, and the greatest of these is charity. You can't love what you don't know. And we Catholics, practically everybody in here is in, you know, roughly the same boat that I'm in. You know, we got garbage when we were in school. We got garbage. I learned how to make glitter Jesuses. Remember those? Remember the Elmer's glue? Remember the felt? Remember the little glitter that Sister Crazy would walk in with? Now, boys and girls, we're going to make, cut out a little velvet dove, and glue it on a banner, and you're going to walk into church feeling really stupid. That was how the faith was passed on to us. We were robbed, and now we have to go back and claim what's ours. We have to realize we were robbed, and we have to go back and claim what's ours. In the process of doing that, the reality of the civilization and the cultural mess that we're in kind of opens up in front of us. And yes, you must respond. You must do something. Prayer and action. Mary and Martha. Remember the story? And Mary's there, Martha's rushing around, you know, getting the dishes set, and you know, the dishwasher's jammed, and the microwave won't work, and she gets all irritated and says to, you know, our Lord, well, that's fine, Mary's sitting there, I'm running around here doing all the cooking, doing all the cleaning up. And our Lord says, Martha, Martha, you're worried and anxious about many things. Mary has chosen the better course. Not that the other course was bad, just that this one's the better. But when he got done talking to Mary, they all got up and had a nice meal. So both are necessary. Prayer first, as the Council of Trent teaches us, prayer is the raising and lifting of the heart and mind to God. And that's how we're going to spend eternity, hopefully. So practice makes perfect. Start with prayer, move on to action. Yes, go to the Planned Parenthood, you know, killing chambers. You know, write letters, go to the editorials, start education groups in your homes. Turn off the TV. Who cares who's going to be the next judge on American Idol? Who cares if some stupid, you know, D-list star can dance or not? Who cares? Reorient, step out of that ridiculous, you know, materialistic, who cares attitude. Put down people, put down us, put down all of those things. Pick up Thomas Aquinas, pick up John Henry Newman, pick up St. Augustine, pick up the Gospels, pick up the Catechism, and make it your life. Think of Rick Santorum. Well, as a first of all, I voted for him in the Michigan primary, and secondly, I tried to do the Democratic thing, which is I went to the local cemetery, dug up 7 corpses, and tried to have them all vote for him too. Some of them were just too decomposed; I couldn't get their hands on. Okay, this is a. Some of the specific political things. Somebody makes a comment here, asks the question, as I understand this, Mormons are anti-Catholic. How can we vote for a Mormon for president? Mormonism is not anti-Catholic, as in, like, you know, the Mormon church has, the Mormon group has, you know, things in its charter saying, we hate Catholics. But Mormonism is not Christianity, and let's be clear about that. It's not Christianity. Christianity admits of, this goes right back to the 4th century. This is exactly what the Council of Nicaea was about when it was called to settle the question of the divinity of Christ. Mormons reject the divinity of Christ because, ahead of that, they reject the triune God. They reject, as part of their teaching, the Holy Trinity. They do not believe that God is three persons in one God. They don't accept that. Since they do not accept that, they cannot accept that Jesus is divine. So it's not Christian. Interestingly, in America, religious liberty, pluralism, your truth's over there, my truth's over here, Mormonism is a distinctly American religion. It began here in this state. It began with a 14-year-old child throwing some rocks in a hat, looking into the rocks and shaking them, putting space in there, pulling space out, and telling adults around them, around him, that he had just been told a secret from an angel. He went and dug up some supposedly golden tablets, and in those tablets, golden tablets, somehow I managed to put dozens and dozens and dozens of big gold tablets onto the back of a horse, a mule, and those tablets told the story of the lost tribes of Israel, and that those lost tribes of Israel, the 10 tribes that were wiped out in the Syrian invasion, the kingdom of the north, somehow were dispersed and managed to find their way over here to what is the North American continent. And here they sat for centuries and centuries and centuries. And then Jesus came to them, and they had developed into these two Native American tribes. And he came to them, and they were given the Book of Mormon. And contained in the philosophy, the philosophical underpinnings, is that Mormonism admits that if you are an elder in the church, and only if you're an elder in the church, when you die, you become a god, and you get your own planet. And on that planet, you have all of your children worshiping you. And that's why Mormons have so many children and used to be polygamists. Because the more wives you have, the more children you would have. And when you died and went to the next life and you got your own planet, you would have many more people worshiping you. That ain't Christian. Now, is it anti-Catholic? I mean, to use the term anti-Catholic, I think that's probably a bit of a stretch. But look up what Mormonism is. And it's a distinctly American religion. And given the current climate of America, how can you possibly stand up and say, no, that's not true? By the way, Mormons are not pro-life. There's absolutely nothing in the creed of the Mormon religion that is against abortion. Philosophically, there's nothing there. Many of them aren't in support of abortion, but there's nothing embedded in their teachings that says abortion is evil one way or the other. It isn't addressed in their religious teachings. And as we know from Mitt Romney, neither, apparently, is homosexual marriage. He hasn't said, I'd say marriage is okay, says civil unions are okay, I'd allow the civil unions for the people to adopt, but I don't know about calling it marriage. Do you think this election can be a perfect storm, uniting Jews, Protestants, Catholics, and Muslims by confronting a president with his own dehumanizing activities while contrasting the value of law, truth, and original and our original form of government freedom? Don't get caught up in political victories are somehow ordained by God. Do not put your trust in princes. Do not put your trust in horses. Despite the horse's power, it cannot save. Should we be involved politically? Yes. But we must be involved politically, always anchored in the truth. And I have to tell you that it's just my own personal meanderings right now, and I haven't arrived at something, but for the first time in my life, I may not vote in this election. I don't know if that's right, wrong, whatever. I don't know, but yeah, well, I have to walk in, and lots of people have this dilemma to go through right now. Am I going to go pull the lever for somebody who I have absolutely not one ounce of guarantee that if a Supreme Court justice comes up for a nominee, which probably two or three of them will this next time around, that he's going to give one hoot about them being pro-life, Romney, or he's already come out publicly and said he's perfectly fine, in principle. How he manages to affect this in law or executive power, I don't know. But he doesn't have, in principle, whole, in truth, a problem, a moral problem, with individuals of the same gender having sex together, and then putting impressionable children into that situation. And it's very difficult for me to go pull the lever for that, even if the other one is worse. I don't know. But I just want to say that we have to be very careful, you know, and I know, because Obama is, you know, I've said this publicly before, I'll say it again, I think the man is possessed of the diabolical mind. I absolutely think that. But I do know that the diabolical mind is much craftier than Mike Voris' mind. And if the diabolical mind senses that a useful idiot tool of hell is about to lose an election, well, there's absolutely, he has no loyalty. Satan has no loyalty to anything or anyone, not even himself. So there's absolutely nothing to stop him jumping Obama's ship and jumping right onto Romney's ship. So, you know, we have to be very, very discerning. We do know this. That under, what do we have since Roe versus Wade? Nixon, Reagan, Bush, Ford. By the way, you all know that as a little historical side note, political side note, Gerald Ford ascended to the presidency without ever winning one single election for anything in his life. Nothing. And even when, you know, most likely to become president of the United States, vote in high school. Nothing. Not one vote. Boy, I don't know if the founders foresaw that or not. You know, we've had four Republican presidents since Roe versus Wade, two of them two terms, and the killing goes on. Not an end in sight. And I really do believe that we have to consider that when I hear people like Haley Barbour, who is the Republican National Chairman, make comments like, make comments like, we really have to sort of stay away from these social issues and concentrate on the economy. I'm like, are you showing me your true stripes? So don't. I think the pro-life, theologically conservative, socially conservative vote has been used by Republican leadership to maintain their power. And having said that, I do not know what the answer is. I mean, we've got a system set up by the founders that it's this group or that group. You know, what do you choose? I don't know what you choose. I don't know. Is there a possibility that Roman Catholics will overturn the Health and Human Services Agency's regulations? That's the question that's in front of the courts right now. A company in Colorado, Hercules, what a great name for that, Hercules Industries, I think it's called, filed a suit. They're from Denver. They filed a suit. There are four guys that own a business. I can't remember what they produce, industrial something. And the manufacturer, and they filed a suit and said, you know, this violates our religious beliefs, our conscience, blah, 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 First Amendment, blah, 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 blah. And the federal judge sided with them. That was, yes, Thursday, I believe, and whatever day of the year it is right now. And the federal judge sided with him, but he was very careful to say in his opinion that his opinion pertains strictly to this case before the court right now, just Hercules. But what it does in the legal world is it gives a precedent for another judge to make a springboard off of and all of that. Eventually it winds up in the court and, you know, it's not the job of this court to protect the people from the consequences of their political choices. Is there a place or a country in the world where the snake hiding in the American system doesn't exist? Are we to start behaving as the Christians did who lived under the early century persecutions of the Roman emperors? I don't believe that there is a place in the world where diabolical and demonic activity isn't going on. There are two countries that have been kind of predominantly billed as Catholic countries, kind of the last two Catholic countries, and they are the Philippines and Malta. And the Philippines, it's kind of interesting note, the Philippines is the largest English-speaking Catholic country in the world. And right now, what kind of defines it as Catholic is that the abortion, contraception are illegal in the Philippines. Imagine that. Contraception is illegal. Planned Parenthood for now 13 years, and Charlie and I have been to the Philippines this past February and February of 2011 covering this, is constantly trying to jam through the Filipino legislature, Congress, it's something called the Reproductive Health Bill, Reproductive Health, it's called the RH. And Catholics there, now granted, it's a majority Catholic country, and it's a nice contrast actually to the United States, not a majority Catholic country, and all of a sudden you've got tens of thousands of Protestant denominations who simply can't agree on the truth, so now you've got tens or thousands of different, you know, moral systems, which then from those moral systems fall out how people vote for things, how they live their lives, the choices they make. Well, here in the Philippines, it's a predominantly Catholic, 93%, received the faith very richly, took root. Magellan was killed in the Philippines. That's a big, huge cross where he landed. Franciscan missionaries brought the faith there and stayed there ever since, very, very deep. We know lots of Filipinos in the Detroit area and now obviously many in the Philippines. Very, I have to tell you, they're some of the most beautiful people on the face of the earth. They really are. It's very, I like to call them the Irish of Asia. Putting a plug in for the Irish. And but they have the same, you know, they have a culture rooted in the faith, and that faith is rooted in the truth. So nobody's, or few people are sitting around debating, well, is contraception really evil or is it not? That's a given. So immediately they all band together and will not let this go through. Now the senators and the congressmen, what they're called in the Philippines, but the two houses they have a very similar American system. They are on the take from Planned Parenthood. And Obama. Obama has the U.S. ambassador to the Philippines. Can't remember his name right now. The very first thing this man did when he went to the Philippines, the U.S. ambassador, Obama's man, was to throw a party for all the homosexual Filipinos in Manila at the U.S. Embassy as part of the Obama administration's foreign policy. And if you read the speech that he gave at that party, so you have this, again, morally vacuous system where the morals are determined by whoever happens to win. And the person who wins is determined by people's selfish votes. This person moves in and now begins to infect the world through the whole foreign policy thing. You couldn't send a more diabolical representative out than Hillary Clinton, who has gone around to country after country after country, Nigeria, Kenya, all over the third world, and has proposed that the best way to end poverty is to simply end the poor. Just kill the poor and you'll end, then you'll get done with poverty. And that is the official United States foreign policy thing. So, you know, again, when you're, so no, I don't think there's a country around that the stress fractures are starting to break in the Philippines on this. You simply can't keep resisting the money over and over and over, the lawmakers. But right now that's it. Malta, very interesting story. Malta, up until last year, no divorce, no contraception, no abortion. Last October, in a bitterly fought referendum, 51.68 percent of the people voted to allow divorce. Little by little by little. And as Catholics, you look around the Catholic world, and you know, it's beautiful when you're standing in St. Peter's, and you see every nation under earth, every nation on the planet, people go walking by from. Just sit next to the fountain, and you hear every language on earth. Go out and preach to all nations, baptize them. And when you see that every one of these formerly Catholic countries has given way little by little by little, and the instrument for that has been American cultural imperialism. Our TV shows, our music, our advertising, everything. Satan got a hold of mainstream America, polluted it, hitched his wagon to this civilization, and has corrupted the world. It's a horrible thing to have to consider if you're American. Since St. Paul said, make every effort to preserve the unity that comes from the Spirit, don't you think fellow Christians, Jews, and good-intentioned atheists can unite under the dignity that we are indeed strict of our religious liberty? Yes, I suppose that can happen, but what happens next? You know, we're right back where we started. I mean, we're, you know, 10 years ago we were at that position. See, things flow logically. Once you allow for one thing, well, then the next thing logically flows. This moves along. These aren't isolated, oh, we won this election, now we can go back and work on our cars or go shopping or something. Things flow in a logical order. Okay, let's say that every well-intentioned Catholic, Protestant, Jew, atheist, everybody unites and says, oh, we have to throw this guy out. He's against religious liberty. They vote him out. He loses on a landslide, you know, 70 to 30. Okay, so now whoever, presumably Romney, comes in. Okay, now what? Does abortion go away? Well, no, because, you know, 50% of the population thinks it's perfectly fine. You know, what are we rooting our morality in? Because we've united to preserve religious liberty? Do teenagers stop hearing in high school that, you know, Heather has two mommies and Bobby has two daddies and here's a condom and here's how you put it on and here's a birth control pill, and by the way, we'll take you against your parents' will to, or even knowledge, to the abortion chamber if you need to go there? Does any of that change? Why would it change? We've already had that situation and it hasn't changed. So why would it change? Because we haven't addressed the argument, the core argument of what is the truth. And until we address that, which means we have to address the either deeper question of which religion is right, which religion says the truth and based on what authority, until that question is answered, you cannot say this is objective morality. Because someone else can just say, I disagree. So, yeah. You can get this guy out of office, you can put in this guy, you can get this judge here, you can do it with. But what changes in the end? Before kingdoms change, men must change. Michael, how can I explain, okay, this is a theological question, but I think it's an important one. Michael, how can I explain the origins of the real presence to my 20-year-old niece that has left the church? Someone told her that a pope around 1200 decided to make this change from a symbol. The real presence, as enunciated at the Council of Trent in 1561, is that Jesus Christ, the second person of the Blessed Trinity, is really, truly, and substantially present, body, blood, soul, and divinity, under the appearance of bread and wine. That means that that is Jesus Christ. That's what the church teaches. And when the priest pronounces the words that our blessed Lord did at the Last Supper, this is my body and this is my blood, that in philosophical terms, what's called transubstantiation occurs, that the substance of bread and the substance of wine are annihilated and they are replaced with the substance, the real presence, the substance of body, blood, soul, and divinity of Jesus Christ, really, truly, and substantially. That's what the church teaches. I believe what may be being referenced here around 1200 was actually around 1100. There was a monk, Rasbellius, goofy Middle Ages name, can't remember his name, who started to try to explain why this actually wasn't the case. And he got in trouble with his superiors and blah, 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 and all that. And in the process of doing this, the Pope stepped in and made the Pope at the time stepped in and made sure exactly what this teaching was. Everybody in the church had always accepted the real presence. It was never even a question. The reason this is so important, this particular Pope, because it's the first time in history that a Pope actually had to address it and say, wait a minute, you're wrong. This guy, the Rasbellius, I can't remember his name, I always get him mixed up with Rasputin, and it's not Rasputin. He's the first time, at least we have in recorded history, of somebody in the church who is a cleric actually coming out and publishing something saying it's not really Jesus. So something that many people outside the church don't quite seem to get is when the church announces a dogma, it doesn't make it up on the spot. It simply announces something almost always, 99% of the time, to clarify something that's been challenged. But to merely say we believe this doesn't mean we started believing it at that point. It means we're simply announcing it right now. Like when a man proposes to his beloved, when he says, "Will you marry me?" he didn't just begin loving her at that moment. The question, the statement, is the summation of everything that has gone on before that. And when the popes announce a dogma, that's what a dogma is. As an aside, the real presence, when our Lord says to his apostles at the Last Supper, and fittingly, he says it at the Last Supper, the Gospel of John, "I will not leave you orphans, I will come back to you." He is back with us and never left. If God, I was talking to a friend of mine who converted to the faith this past Easter, young fellow down in Houston, who very much was in love with the pro-life, is still in love with the pro-life movement, and was Protestant, and agreed with all of the church's social and moral teachings, but could not get over this real presence thing. It was like a hump for him. It blocked him, couldn't get it. And I said to him one day, I said, "Do you believe God loves you?" He said, "Yep." I said, "Do you believe that God loves you absolutely, totally, perfectly, in every possible way he can?" He said, "Yep." I said, "Okay. If God could, and he's God, so he could, if he could make himself available, not just in spirit when you pray, but also able to mingle his DNA with you, with yours, physically, in your body, and he did not do that. He chose to withhold himself physically from you. How can you possibly say that he loves you totally?" And that went ding with him. The Eucharist, the Blessed Sacrament, must be Jesus. Necessarily, it must be Jesus, because for him to withhold that possibility from us would mean that he's withholding something of himself from us. He made us body and soul. And in making us body and soul, what lover wants to be separated from his beloved? If you look at any of the churches, and I was going to say great cathedrals, but it's not even the case of cathedrals, it's in neighborhood churches, particularly in Europe, you'll always see in some of them, some older churches in the United States still have this, but you'll notice on the altar, there's, you've all seen pictures or been to St. Peter's, that great big monstrous, Bernini's patina, the big four twisty pillars around the high altar. It's so big, you just go, oh, look at that big thing. But if you take a close look at it, I've got a picture, it's my cell phone screensaver, it's a bedpost. It's a four-post bedpost with the canopy over it. Because in the great, beautiful theology of the church, that altar becomes the place where God comes from heaven to unite himself to his beloved. And for this reason, a man leaves his father and mother and clings to his wife, the church, and the two become one flesh. And there it is depicted in Catholic architecture all over the place. It's, yes, God loves us so much that he will veil himself under the appearance of bread and wine so that he can mingle with us even here. And interestingly enough, as he tells the Jews at Capernaum in John chapter 6, not only is that something for now, but it is a preparation for our flesh for the last day. He who eats my body and drinks my blood abides in me, and I will raise him up on the last day. Why is he talking about the last day and the resurrection of the dead when he's talking about this? Because the two are intimately linked. We will have a glorified body on the last day because we will have received the beginnings of that glory here on earth out of love. It's all about love. At the end of the day, it's all about the intensity, the almost unimaginable, incomprehensible intensity of the love of God for us. It's always about that. How come we haven't received any moral guidelines from the bishops? It's like a Vortex episode. Regarding Obamacare and the HHS, what are we as the laity supposed to do? What can we do when we cannot find a church with priests who speak the truth of our faith? There is so little direction from our parish priests. First of all, with regard to the bishops and Obamacare, once it became clear that Obamacare was what it is, once it was kind of unveiled, and you know, of course that happened after everybody read the bill after they voted for it. Once that became clear, the bishops, to their credit, absolutely snapped to. And to a single bishop, every single one of them condemned the HHS mandate. Every single one of them. Amazingly enough, what popes and prayers and zillions of rosaries and everything else were not, for whatever reason, capable of producing, President Obama was. He united the bishops, at least on this one thing. And the problem, again, on this, on the Obamacare thing and the religious liberty thing, is at the heart of it, the issue is not whether it's unconstitutional. The heart of it is that it's evil. But bishops, again, because we're in this American paradigm, this box, where you cannot talk about moral truth and right and wrong and absolute morality, you have to sort of hang your hat on some other hook. So you have to go chasing down the road of religious liberty. Oh, it's unconstitutional. It's evil! What's wrong with it? It's not that it's unconstitutional. The Constitution means what five judges sitting in the Supreme Court say it means. That's it. That's the American reality. That's it. And that's why the American experiment failed. To pursue this as unconstitutional, even if they win, they meaning the bishops, even if they win, so what? So what? All that will have been accomplished is that the current status quo remains. That's all that will be accomplished. You
you were fighting like mad to lose the game by 7 points as opposed to 30. Who cares? How many of you are aware of the fact that even now, as we sit here on the eve of the Obamacare mandate going into effect August 1st, that even now, as we sit here in this room, July, whatever it is, 28, 29, 28 states in the United States, 28 already have a state version of Obamacare in place. Dioceses all over the country are already, Catholic dioceses all over the country, Protestant houses of worship all over the country, all of these religious institutions all over the country are already living under this mandate, under the form of a state mandate. Health insurance is regulated on a state-by-state basis. 28 states already have legislation on the books, and everybody's living with it like nobody's business. That if you have a certain number of employees, you must provide in your health insurance contraceptive/abortifacient reproductive health care. You must pay for it. It's already the case in over half the states. So what are we fighting for? A principle? Let's say the bishops win this. Let's say the courts somehow rule in their favor. And there's a religious exemption granted. And the little narrow definition of a religious exemption is broadened. What about the Catholic business owner who has nothing to do with the church and his regular business? What about the Catholic family who run their own business and, you know, have to provide insurance for their own family members in addition to their employees? Even if the bishops win this, it doesn't affect them at all. Starting August 1st, that's it. This is where we are. It is not the job of this court to protect the people from the consequences of their political choices. For Obamacare to be gone, Obama has to be gone. For Obamacare to be gone, the Senate must be filled with people who recognize the evil of this. At least 51 of them, or 50 if the vice president is a Republican, or not Biden, another disloyal traitor to God, not the country. And the House of Republicans would have to be filled with enough people. Let me remind you, for those of you who are all rah-rah-rah-rah Republican, get the Republicans elected, yay-yay, blah-blah. Let me remind you of something. Susan Collins, the Republican senator from Maine, when Obamacare was still in the Senate hearings in committee, that one Republican woman cast the necessary vote to vote it out of committee and to put it on the floor of the U.S. Senate where it passed. Do not put your faith in princes. Do not put your trust in horses. Despite their power, they cannot save. Till men change, kingdoms can't. Why priests will not preach? Okay, first of all, in defense of priests, some priests who want to preach the truth, the moment they mention abortion, same-sex marriage, contraception, divorce and remarriage, why haven't you been to confession? This is the real presence. The second they mention those things, Catholics who have their heads twisted around for 10, 20, 40 years and now belong to the Church of Nice, the Church of the lack of tolerance, except their lack of tolerance toward traditional Catholicism, immediately write the bishop's office, the chancery, headed by liberals, left and right, call the priest in, crucify him, and ship him off to Our Lady of the garbage dump at the farthest ends of the diocese. Many priests know that. And we know this because you would not believe the number of priests that we talk to. Good, solid, faithful priests who we talk to. dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of priests contact us on a regular basis about this very kind of thing. Solid, good, orthodox priests. Take a break, and switch tape. I just looked out. Well, now you tell me. But yeah, it's a, we get emails from, I got an email from a priest in Ireland last night, and showed it to Charlie because we both know the priests where we stayed when we were in Ireland, and I can say this now because we're not rolling tape or anything. Yeah. And we did a vortex, I can't do it now, so I haven't said where he's from. Good. We did a vortex on, two vortexes, Monday and Tuesday, on the absolute insanity of the homosexual mafia inside the clergy of the church, and the response from priests was overwhelming. The response from men, good, solid, heterodox, heterosexual, orthodox men who were driven out of the seminary by the gay club, was unbelievable. So there are priests right now in dioceses all over the world suffering at the hands of modernist, progressive, liberal, gay-friendly, essential dissidents and heretics inside the church. So oftentimes a priest will have to make, I'm not saying what right or wrong, I'm just telling you what we hear. Oftentimes a priest will make the prudential judgment that it is better for him to not say some things directly from the pulpit because he has more people in this congregation than he gets shipped off, than to address people individually in confession, go to their houses and have dinner with them and talk very quietly, that sort of thing. Again, I'm not saying it's right or wrong, I'm saying because they know what will happen to them. And we've heard from a number of priests as well that when they start preaching the truth, all of a sudden some sexual abuse allegation pops up. You looked at some child the wrong way, the office has investigated you, and we found the charges to be credible, so we are removing you from your duties right now. They sit in limbo land sometimes for years. I know a priest who has had to return home. I don't want to say what diocese he's from. The priest got in touch with me and had to return home to go live with his parents for years, where he had to take up gardening. Priest, a priest of Almighty God. Because he dared preach the truth from the pulpit, got shipped off. Now, his cross is his cross in relationship to that, but in his mind, he's like, well, what if I would have gone about this a different way? The fact that priests are even put in this position is diabolical. It's demonic. Now, there are other priests who simply will not treat these topics from the pulpit, because they simply don't believe the faith anymore. I'm not sure they ever did. They simply lost the faith, if they ever had it. And that's true also of bishops. For the condition of the church to reach what it is now has not happened by accident. It's not happened by accident. It has come about because we travel all over the world and we hear the same stories every single place we go. These people don't know each other, both for the most part, and we hear the same stories every single place we go. You know, a progressive modernist, you know, hates the traditional Latin Mass, you know, signs it at 3 o'clock in the afternoon somewhere in like the most dangerous part of town, on and on and on. If you go onto the internet right now, you'll see a posting by Bishop Robert Lynch. You'll find saying his name because he put it out there on the internet. He's the bishop of St. Petersburg
he actually makes fun of his memories of the Latin Mass when he was a boy. Because I remember being in school and, you know, the eighth grade girls were screeching through a Mass and, you know, trying to be a choir, and I'm reading this going, oh my God, is this a successor of the apostles? This is a successor of the apostles? What a horribly disrespectful thing to say. That Mass produced the greatest saints in the history of the church. St. Francis attended that Mass. St. Ignatius attended that Mass. St. Robert Bellarmine, St. Catherine of Siena, St. Catherine of Genoa, all of them. That Mass produced saints, the greatest saints in the history of the church, for 1,200 years. What saint has been produced from this gobbledygook, watered-down theology we've had for the last 50 years? No one. Priests who are afraid or trying to figure out a different way, you know, keep them in your prayers. Priests who despise the faith. Remember, our Lord had Judas. None of this should come as a surprise. Our Lord had Judas. Keep them more in your prayers. Imagine what the tortures of hell must be for a soul who has been ontologically changed and has the mark of priesthood on him for eternity in hell. The terror inflicted on that soul by the demons in their delight. Remember what Satan said to our Lord at the Last Supper. I demand that you give me these so that I may sift them like wheat. Pray for them. What do we do when we can't find a church with a priest who speaks the truth of our faith? There's so little direction for our parish priests. Along the same lines, again, this is a prudential call. You must consider whether your faith is being nourished. Now, sometimes people go to Mass and, you know, maybe they're traveling or, you know, whatever, but on your regular situation, are you going to a parish where you hear the faith, where you are nourished in the faith? If you are not, and you are capable of going to another parish, you must go to that other parish for your own soul, and so that you are not sitting there supporting a watered-down version of the faith. Get up and go. If you have children and they see people walking up to receive the body and blood of our blessed Lord, chewing gum, chatting, talking on their cell phone, dressed like harlots, with guys glaring at them, dressed inappropriately, you see that in a church and you have your children with you, I don't care if you have to drive 10 hours to get to Mass. Those children's souls are your responsibility. You do not want your children see our blessed Lord defiled. That's your responsibility. That's why you have those children, to get them to heaven. Do you ever speak at colleges or high schools? And if so, what is the reaction of the students? Interestingly enough, I was talking to students just like said Thursday in Romania, and when we talked to students, their reaction is generally kind of a bit of a shock that they don't know anything of this. The thorough anti-catechesis that has taken place in the church by the forces of the anti-church has been so thorough that even young men and women who consider themselves good Catholics don't know the slightest thing about the faith. In our conversations, in the talk I gave in Iași, Romania, I said, as I was saying, these are Catholic kids in front of me from all over the country. I'm thinking, well, they know these things about the faith, bad assumption. I said, in the course of my conversation with them, I said, are you, I just happened to drop the term sanctifying grace, and they all kind of looked at me like they have a slightest idea what I was talking about. And I said, do you know that term? It wasn't a translation problem because they were all following all the rest of the talk. And they're like, no. I'm like, you don't know what sanctified grace is? They're like, no. I said, do you know what actual grace is? No. Do you know what being in a state of mortal sin means? No. Well, let me make it clear for you. And we went on a little couple of minutes of catechesis. The numbers of them came up afterwards and said, thank you very much for telling us the truth. See, we're wired for the truth. And I have to tell you, half the people that work at the studio are Charlie's age, or, you know, within a couple of years, one way or the other. They're 20s, maybe touching 30, half of them. The young have a heart open to the truth. All you have to do is show it to them. They haven't gotten, you know, limpy and creaky bones and gray hair and everything like us, where we're all invested in our sin, you know? We are. We're invested in our sin. We've done this so long. We've been down this road for so long, it's hard to turn around and go back. The young really haven't been polluted quite like that yet. Tell them the truth and they come running to it. Some. But they come with an embrace that's absolutely beautiful to behold. It's humbling. It's absolutely humbling. But those of you that know the faith, this is why you know it. You know it. To tell them the truth. To pass it on to them. And don't worry about what happens to you in this life. It doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter what happens to you in this life. Granted, nobody's thrilled about, you know, being tortured in prison, but skipping that for the moment. Hopefully forever. Just tell the truth. Just tell the truth. That is our blessed Lord in the tabernacle. This is the faith established by Jesus Christ on Peter and the apostles. This is the truth. And show them why it's the truth. Of course, that makes it incumbent on all of us, of course, to be able to explain that, which means we must know it. What's the most important action we can take to help change the fear some clergy have in speaking out on the truth? Talk to them and tell them, thank you, Father, for saying the truth. Get to be friends with priests. Let them see your deep love of the faith. Encourage them. They are discouraged. They are discouraged every single turn. They're discouraged. They're discouraged by their own failings, personally, as we all are. But beyond that, the other failings they see of their fellow priests in the priesthood, of the way society treats them. I can't remember who the priest was now. I heard tell during the height of the whole sex abuse scandal that he was walking through the airport. He had his collar on. He was walking to the airport, and there was a mother there with a young child, or it was a boy or girl, and he happened to see the young child, and he was like, well, hello, or something like that, and the mother snatched the child away because he was a priest. You can't be human and not have something like that affect you. And over, and every time you turn on, you know, what's his face, who's the late night guy, Jay Leno, all those guys, constantly jokes about priests and the whole bit and everything. Oh yeah, because, you know, we all know that nothing else ever happens, you know, anywhere else. You know, if only the horrible crisis that happened at Penn State just recently, if only all of those men would have been married. Oh wait, they were. Is that not the thing that gets leveled against the priesthood? Oh, because you're all celibate, you're all that. Really? Yeah, you should have a married clergy, really? What about all the married pedophiles there are who live in homes? The priesthood is constantly derided. Give me those men so that I may sift them like wheat. Why? Why does Satan go after the Catholic priesthood? Because the Catholic priesthood brings Christ down from heaven, physically present to us. And the last question here, what made you so Catholic? I'm Episcopalian. Did you have a spiritual awakening? Please share your story. Thank you for all you do. Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you for the last question. When I got into TV news, for me, it wasn't the greatest environment. I was young.
always wound up working the late news. You get off at 11:30 or midnight. 11:30 or midnight, you don't have to be in the next day until noon, 1. Young, relatively decent shape. Let's all go out and get a drink. Do the math. It turns into quite an unsightly, unseemly thing. And I was quickly absorbed into a life of mortal sin. And had I died any time during that, I would have gone to hell. I would have deserved to have gone to hell. And that's the choice I would have made. For whatever reason, our blessed Lord was able to preserve me through, not my efforts and certainly not my merit, but my mother, who's buried over in St. Augustine's Cemetery in Ossining, in Westchester. We're going to go make a visit to her grave tomorrow. For years and years and years, years and years and years, prayed left and right for me. If you know the St. Monica, St. Augustine story, well, here it is in the 20th century. Not St. Augustine, but St. Monica. Mother's name was Anne, is Anne. And she used to send me constantly. I'd come in sometimes, not always alone, in the wee hours of the morning, hit the answering machine, remember the old little cassette things, hit the answering machine, and I'd have this 20-minute message of, you shouldn't be out so late, that's horrible, you know, after midnight, that's all the devil's work, and blah, 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 every single night. Every single night. And I did, every night. And I would keep it. After a while, I kind of caught on. Well, I know what this is about, so I push fast forward. And you know, I'm to Jesus got push fast forward to sin. And I get the mail. Wake up the next morning, get the mail, open it up, and there's a rosary in it, a miraculous medal in it, a book about the four last things: death, judgment, heaven, hell. On. And this went on for years, years and years. Gosh, the love of a mother. And finally, my mother, I found this out after the fact. My mother told me, at one point I just gave up. And I said, Jesus, I don't care what you have to do to me. Do whatever you have to do, but spare the eternal lives of my two sons. And my brother, for a different set of reasons, which are his affair, were both off the rails of the faith. And my mother said, told me that about 3 weeks or so, roughly, after that, she was diagnosed with stomach cancer. And they actually found it by accident. It was very early. She was going in for something totally different. They stumbled across it. And they performed surgery a couple days later, said they got it all. A few months later, it was back, fully back, stage 4, and they told her she had 2 or 3 months left to live. This is when they were living over here in Westchester. She was down in Sloan Kettering all the time. And when they told her that they had 2 or 3 months, she had 2 or 3 months left to live, I had left TV news in my career at this point. I started my own video production company and was producing commercials for General Motors. And while I was there, if any of you own your own business, you know you can't be gone for that long. I mean, you are your business. So I said to my dad on the phone, I said, well, Dad, you know, you're going to need help doing that. You know, you guys have to move out here. So my parents sold their place in Scarborough very quickly, a couple of weeks, moved out to Detroit, got all settled down, and then you start that, you know, horrible death watch. You know, 2 months of so going through thing, and then my mom just kept living. She came out here, she kind of plateaued, and she just kept living. And she was obviously sick. She used to describe the pain in her stomach as just a stomach full of broken glass. That every time she would turn, she'd just feel these like thousands of like scrapes and daggers inside. And she lived in that for, in that state. And I am a very hard-headed, thick person. So after my mom came to Detroit, got settled in, kind of the shock was over. You know, that was in July when they moved out. She was supposed to be dead sometime between August and September-ish. Thanksgiving came, nothing changed. Christmas, nothing. You know, New Year's, her birthday in March, Mother's Day. And it kind of became a joke. I said, Mom, you sure the doctor like wasn't reading someone else's file? And I mean, she was clearly sick, but she had not gotten worse. And in the meantime, I had retreated
right back to my old ways. And so I was out producing a commercial for Hummer in Denver in August, and my brother's wife called me and said that my brother's name is Marshall, said that Marshall had just died of a heart attack at 48. And no warning, no nothing, just absolutely. So he looked to be the picture of health. He almost made the U.S. Olympic swim team. His youth, he loved swimming. They moved down to Corpus Christi so he could swim out in the Gulf of Mexico every day. I swam out a mile and back every day unless there was a hurricane. And so it was an absolute total shock when he died. I went down to the funeral in Corpus Christi. My parents obviously couldn't go because of my mother's health. I went down to the funeral, and while I was there, I went into the funeral home and I went up to Marshall's body. I called my mother on my cell phone and said, "Mom, I'm standing here over Marshall. Do you want me to say or do anything?" And she said, she used to call me Pet, it's an Irish term of endearment. She said, "Yes, Pet, give him a kiss for me and tell him how much I love him and that I hope to see him soon." And that really, that was the belt across the face. And that all of a sudden I realized everything of how I was living my life was, am I out of my mind? Yes, the answer is. And I came back, and from that point on, now the conversations I was having with my mother were much more real. And I had to admit to myself, you know, because I had a bunch of reasons I could make all kinds of excuses, and I did, and all of that and everything, but I had to change. I had to change. 10 months later, my mother died on June 15th, 2004, and I went up to her body in the coffin, put my left hand on her womb, and I said, "Mom, what you went through for me, you will not have gone through in vain. I'm a changed man." And from that moment on, I decided I need to do something. I've come back to the faith. So for that next year, from summer of 2004 to about the summer of 2005, maybe into the fall a little bit, I read every single thing I could get my hands on about the faith. I think I must have read, honestly, 10,000 pages. I read every saint I could find, everything, absolutely everything, and became so wanting. It wasn't a case that I want to make up for my sins. I mean, it's probably in there somewhere, but it was this beautiful thing that I've been given again because of the agony that my mother went through. And if there is anything that demonstrates the beautiful Catholic theology of redemptive suffering, there it is. You know, my mother said, you know, "Do whatever you have to do to me to afford the grace to be able to be passed to him to save him." Why did she do it? Out of love. Purely out of love. Love of God, first of all, and love of me, second of all. And I say that, I was very, very uncomfortable sharing that story at the very beginning of when we were doing this 5-6 years ago, because I really don't want any of this to be about me, and I truly mean that. But I do say that because I know that so many of you out there probably have similar situations with family members and, you know, children or adult children, you know, brothers, you know, whoever. Do not give up hope. Remember, the absolute bottom line truth of Christianity is that the innocent pay for the guilty. The innocent pay for the guilty. That is the entire message of the crucifix and why it should be present front and center at every single mass. Visible crucifix, not a cross, a crucifix. Because it is a sign of absolute perfect love. So if you're in that situation or you know someone who is in that situation, never stop praying. Never stop praying. 20 years, St. Monica prayed for St. Augustine. 20 years. And she finally, in her exasperation, went to St. Ambrose. She all know the story of the Bishop of Milan. And said, listen, he said, "God will never refuse the tears of a mother spent so much for their son." Never give up that hope. Ask whatever you have to ask of God to save souls. Every saint in the church became a saint because that was their number one concern. saving souls. We finish up with a Hail Mary.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end.
Sacred Heart of Jesus, Immaculate Heart of Mary, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God love you all. Keep us in your prayers. Thank you.